Henry George was born in Philadelphia on September 2, 1839, the second of 10 children of Richard S.H. George and Catherine Pratt George. His father, a devout Episcopalian, published religious texts and sent George to the Episcopal Academy in Philadelphia. Resisting his religious upbringing, he left school at the age of 14 and in 1855 set sail for Australia and India as a cabin boy aboard the massive sea vessel, the Hindu. George eventually ended up in San Francisco, where he worked as a typesetter. In 1861, he married Annie Corsina Fox, dressed in a borrowed suit. In the mid-1860s, George went to work as a printer for the San Francisco Times, where he began to submit articles and editorials. In 1868, the Overland Monthly published one of his essays, What the Railroad Will Bring Us, which remained required reading in California schools for decades. In the article, he argued that the boom in railroad construction and the completion of the first transcontinental railroad would only benefit the lucky few who owned land and capital near railroad lines, while the rest of the population struggled to eke out a living competing for low-wage jobs. In 1867, he became the managing editor of the paper. In 1870, while riding his horse in the Oakland foothills, which overlook San Francisco Bay, Henry George experienced a revelation. I asked a passing teamster, for want of something better to say, what land was worth there? I don't know exactly, but there is a man over there who will sell some land for $1,000 an acre. Like a flash, it came over me that there was the reason of advancing poverty with advancing wealth. With the growth of population, land grows in value, and the men who work it must pay more for the privilege. These observations supplied the theme and title for his 1879 book, Progress and Poverty, which was a great success, selling over 3 million copies. In it, George proposed a simple solution to inequality and industrial depression, one tax on the market price of land that would replace all federal, state, and local taxes. His proposal became known as the single tax. In 1880, now a popular writer and speaker, George moved to New York City. In 1886, he campaigned for mayor as the candidate of the United Labor Party. He came in second, more than the Republican candidate, Theodore Roosevelt. The election was won by Tammany Hall candidate, Abram Stevens Hewitt, by what many of George's supporters believed was fraud. Henry George died in 1897 after a series of strokes. More than 100,000 people attended his funeral, the city's largest since the death of Abraham Lincoln. The birthplace of Henry George in Philadelphia has been restored and is now open to the public. There are dozens of family photographs, correspondence, political cartoons, and memorabilia, both of George and the single tax movement. Additionally, the birthplace houses over 10,000 primary source documents, all of which provide a fascinating glimpse into his life and philosophy.
Thanks for coming. This is the reopening of the Henry George Birthplace, and also it's the opening of the Henry George Archive Center. Now, I'm the president of the Board of Trustees of the Henry George School of Social Science. We agreed to back this project because we found an extraordinary talent who could carry it out, execute it, do it, think it through, and make it the success it is. So without further ado, I want to introduce the project manager of the Philadelphia Birthplace and Archive Center, Alexandra Lau. Come and take it over. Your show.
Thank you. So thank you all for being here and here to join us in celebrating the opening or the reopening of the Henry George Birthplace Archive and Historical Research Center. As the name suggests, our mission is threefold. We want to promote historical and scholarly research, to serve as a central repository of archival documents and information on Henry George and the Georgist movements. And we want to preserve the Henry George birthplace as the only surviving residence of Henry George. Now, towards serving these goals, I've worked over the past year with the Henry George School to renovate this just remarkable building and protect the items that are within it. We've also framed and reframed photographs, pictures, and other visual material connected to Henry George, his family, and other individuals associated with the movement. We've also restored two antique display cabinets that are in the first floor, and they are displaying archival material and artifacts connected to Henry George and the Georgist movement. We've also digitized more than 10,000 documents, including hundreds of letters written by Henry George, members of his family, and other prominent individuals within the single tax movement. Slowly, these documents are being uploaded to our website and making their way into various collections. You can see some of them at hgarchives.org. Now, while the immediate goal of this project has been to preserve the history of Henry George and the Georgist movement, the greater purpose has been to promote public and scholarly awareness and interest in Henry George and his ideas. Now, although Henry George's name is not frequently heard today, his ideas are everywhere, and they could not be more timely. The near collapse of the world's economy in 2008 and the deep disparity of the recovery since have reignited long-standing arguments over capitalism's inherent ability to produce both great wealth and great poverty. As it did during Henry George's time, this paradox confronts the majority of the nation's wage earners whose real incomes fail to keep pace with the increasing cost of student loan and housing debt. Meanwhile, the richest 1% of the population enjoys more wealth and power than at any other time in the nation's history. Now, as this wealth-poverty conundrum continues to plague social progress, I believe George's ideas are primed to regain momentum, and they've already begun to do so, as recent articles in the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, Rolling Stone magazine can attest. Now, with the help of the Henry George School, the Henry George Birthplace and Historical Center promises to play an integral role in promoting public discussion of these issues by making George's ideas and their history more widely accessible. Now, with that closing remark, I'd like to introduce the keynote speakers. I'm going to introduce all of them at first, and so just hold your applause until we welcome them. Our first keynote speaker is Mary Pilon. Mary is an award-winning sports reporter for the New York Times and Wall Street Journal. And the topic of her speech today is on her new book, The Monopolists: Obsession, Fury, and the Scandal Behind the World's Favorite Board Game. Following Mary will be Ed Dotson. Ed retired from Fannie Mae in 2005, where he had worked as a market analyst and a business manager. He currently serves as the senior researcher at the Henry George Historical Research Center and is a volunteer instructor at Temple and Burlington County Colleges. The topic of his talk are the causes of the 2008 financial crisis and how they could have been avoided. Edward Nell will conclude the speaking portion of our event with a macro analysis on the U.S. economy and the problem of inequality today. Edward is the chief economist at Recipco and the former Malcolm B. Smith Professor of Economics at the New School of Social Research. He is a graduate of Princeton University and Oxford's Magdalen College, which he attended on a Rhodes Scholarship. There's also a display in the classroom, which is the sort of third floor of our building, of Monopoly games, the sort of Georgist origins of the board game Monopoly, courtesy of Richard Biddle. So speaking of Monopoly, let's hear Mary Pilon.
Thank you so much for that lovely introduction, and thanks for having me here. I was joking earlier, it's so much more fun to come here when you're not on book deadline and when it's out on shelves. The Birthplace was a huge resource in figuring out Monopoly. And I'll talk a little bit about how I first, you know, crossed paths with Henry George, which the short answer is by accident, a little bit about the game, and then I'll be around afterwards if people have questions. It took me 300 pages, so I'll do my best in just a few minutes. So I came across the story of Monopoly and Henry George's involvement totally by accident. In 2009, I was on staff of the Wall Street Journal. I was part of the money and investing team, which is the part of the paper that's tasked with covering Wall Street and the economy, which, as you'll remember, in 2009 was really depressing. And I have always loved games and puzzles, and I was going to mention in passing, everybody knows Monopoly was invented during the Great Depression. I thought it'd be a funny reference in light of, you know, the theme that real estate was obviously playing in the financial crisis. And I was looking around for the story and I was so frustrated because it wasn't adding up. I, like everybody, thought Monopoly came about during the Great Depression. It was invented by a man named Charles Darrow. It was tucked in the box that I had played as a child. And I thought, oh, I'm such an idiot. You know, here we are writing about derivatives and investment banks, and I can't get the sentence about the board game right because the Journal is a paper that just has to be bulletproof. Every single sentence is agonized over by reporters and editors. So I came across this man named Ralph Ansbach, who I had done the math, and I had seen that he had been involved in litigation with Parker Brothers in the 70s, and I thought, and you always have this feeling as a reporter where you don't know who's going to answer your call. You don't know who's going to scream at you. You just never know what you're going to get. So I contacted him on a whim, and I thought, you know, I know this sounds crazy, but I see you spent a lot of time in litigation with Parker Brothers. I'm a reporter at the Journal. I'm just trying to find out the truth about Monopoly. And he immediately got back to me and said, oh, I know all about it. For 40 years, I've been investigating this. So that eventually became an article at the Journal, which then became the book. And the story that he told me, which I ended up spending 5 years researching, which is how I ended up here, was that it was actually invented by a woman, Lizzie McGee, who was an impassioned follower of Henry George. So not only did Monopoly, and she was also a very outspoken feminist, her own politics were fascinating. Her father, James McGee, had given her a copy of Progress and Poverty, and James McGee turned out to be a fascinating character. He had traveled with Abraham Lincoln during the Lincoln-Douglas debates. He was a very influential newspaper owner in Illinois. So once I figured out what those roots were, the idea that this woman would hear about Henry George and that his beliefs would really resonate with her wasn't too surprising. And the idea of a woman creating a board game was really unusual. When she received her patent in 1904 for the Landlord's Game, fewer than 1% of patents were given to women. So she was pretty extraordinary. But the idea of using board games as a teaching tool wasn't totally novel. Milton Bradley and George Parker himself had really used them as ways of communicating a political message. And so you have to remember, I'm coming across this all in 2009 and 10. And the idea that Monopoly started out as a critique of capitalism or questioning elements of it. And at Occupy Wall Street, Mr. Monopoly was being plastered on these signs at another moment of economic crisis seemed so funny and fitting to me that, you know, all this time later, the ideology was coming full circle. And I was fascinated by how she used this game, and she had a lot of writings and short stories where she talks about income inequality and all these things that were being discussed in the pages of the paper every single day. So I felt like I was getting this time machine, but I was right back where I was every day in the newsroom. For the last 5 years, people have asked me, why have you spent all this time writing about board games? You know, there's a lot of things you could spend time, you know, writing a book about or any other project. And I just feel like if we can't get the story of Monopoly right, we can't get anything else right. And, you know, I write about legal issues and business issues, and I have friends who are war reporters, and like, these are really critical things. And this place and others really showed me the role of real-time news and newspapers, and reading about Henry George and how he was covered in the time completely changed the way I view it. So I think that there's an important role in not just questioning things, but also being analytical and thinking about who these characters are that make history. And the more we have places like this and documents and can connect people with these real life characters who aren't just people in textbooks, I think we're all better for it. So thank you.
Hi, Mary.
Hello.
Thanks for coming.
Of course.
Obvious question. What made you write the book on Monopoly?
I came across this book totally by accident. I, like most people, thought it was invented by a man during the Great Depression. Turns out that story is not exactly true. And in fact, the game originated with a woman in 1904 who was an impassioned follower of Henry George.
What is the future of Monopoly as you see it and from your perspective now?
Well, the game itself is on all sorts of different platforms. It's played on the iPhone. It's played on the iPad. It has a whole new digital life to it. But I think what's interesting about the game itself is that it started out as a teaching tool to show some of the criticisms of capitalism. And when I started reporting the book, Occupy Wall Street was a big news story that I was covering. And it was interesting to see the iconography of the game used as a critique again, almost more than a century later. So I wonder, you know, how the game as a symbol will evolve and whether it'll kind of end up getting back to its roots.
Okay.
How we got to where we are and what we can expect down the road based on our economic system is worrying a lot of us. And twice a year since I've been retired from Fannie Mae, I do an update on the economy. All I do is compile the government statistics that come out and add my own sort of perspective to that presentation. Goes out to about 700 subscribers, including economists and other professors. And I've been pleased to see that even though I have a good deal of commentary based on Henry George's analysis in there, that a number of professors have written to me and told me they have asked permission to use the material in their classroom. So that speaks well as well to the improved perception of Henry George's contribution. And what really impresses me about George is that he came up with a viable theory of the business cycle. And we still do not have that from mainstream economics. The debate, you know, between all the economists over what school of thought is the prominent one to believe in goes on. So what follows is a succinct examination of the historical record, the underlying market forces and ongoing stresses that are pulling us toward yet another bust that could be worse than the one that occurred in 2008. To start with, we need to acknowledge that the United States economy has never been very stable. Between 1948 and 2007, there have been 10 recessionary periods of varying duration. Lurking in the background of each business cycle was the Federal Reserve Board deciding whether to buy or sell government securities, raise or lower interest rates charged to member banks, or raise or lower currency reserve requirements on those same banks. One characteristic of the U.S. economic system that has remained a constant from its earliest inception is the addiction to speculation. Asset bubbles are nothing new. They have persisted since the colonial era when speculation in land dominated investment activity. Few economists or policymakers were aware of or expressed concern over the dramatic increases in income and wealth concentration that occurred during the decades leading up to the 1930s. A similar level of unconcern existed in the 1990s. By the mid-2000s, the concentration of income in the top 1% of households had returned to the level reached on the eve of the Great Depression. As Henry George would have observed, this was a sure sign the economy was in for great trouble. As former World Bank economist Joseph Stiglitz has been telling anyone who will listen, every change in law related to property and to the taxation of income and property disproportionately favors what is called rent-seeking activities over the production of goods and the delivery of services. Other economists specializing in what is called public choice theory focus on the continuous lobbying of government by special interests as another category of rent-seeking activities with quasi-monopolistic consequences as well as the destabilization of the economy. It is out of this systemic set of legal arrangements that booms develop to a point that the increasing costs of living and doing business can no longer be absorbed or passed on to others. As a consequence, the growth in household debt was skyrocketing at a rate far greater than increases in household incomes coming up to the last recessionary downturn. Until the early 1970s, one of the characteristics of the U.S. financial sector was the restriction on the payment of interest on demand deposits, that is, checking accounts, and the imposition of maximum interest rates on other types of bank accounts and interest charges. In 1971, two innovative money managers created the first money market mutual fund in the United States to circumvent these restrictions. This was the first development that changed everything, in my opinion. This new investment vehicle, named the Reserve Fund, attracted investors interested in preserving liquidity while obtaining a higher rate of return than offered by the banks. This was also the time when stagflation hit the country. The price of fossil fuel skyrocketed. Inflation averaged over 8% in 1978 and hit 15% in 1980. Paul Volcker, now running the Federal Reserve, decided that the only course of action was to lift restriction on interest rates. The accepted price for taming inflation would be recession and rising unemployment. What also resulted was a dramatic increase in the movement of financial resources into the money market mutual funds. A major source of these resources was the savings account balances held by the nation's savings institutions, our deposits. By 1995, one out of three savings institutions would fail. Deregulation fostered consolidation of the financial services industry, allowing thrifts and commercial banks to merge. University of Chicago economics professor Mason, I'm sorry, University of California economics professor Mason Gaffney, one of the few economists who has specialized in the study of property market cycles, commented on what he saw as the state of macroeconomic understanding at the time. Quote, by the end of the 1970s, there was a general recognition that fiscal and monetary policy had failed. Instead of fine-tuning, we had stagflation. Keynesianism foundered as it steered between the shoals of inflation and the rocks of unemployment and ran onto both at once. While the Federal Reserve struggled with insufficient tools to manage the nation's money supply, the deepening recession gave new life to pre-Keynesian policy options described as supply-side economics. As taxes were lowered across the board, the stage was set for a shift to economic activity, emphasizing the markets for financial instruments and for real estate. These are markets driven by speculation and rich in fees taken by a long list of participants. Once Paul Volcker was certain inflation had been beaten out of the economy, the Fed began to lower the rate of interest charged to member banks. The Fed also expanded its purchase of government securities, releasing cash into the economy. As mortgage interest rates fell, the property markets regained their upward momentum. Until 2008 and the fall in property prices, many residential properties sat on land comprising well above 50% of the total value. During the Reagan years, spending on domestic programs actually continued to increase, but at a slower rate than previously. However, spending on the military skyrocketed. Alan Greenspan replaced Paul Volcker at the Fed in August of 1987. Greenspan believed in market forces and thought regulation of the banks unnecessary. 2 months after Greenspan came to the Fed, the overheated stock market came to a sudden crash. Black Monday, as it came to be known, began in Hong Kong and quickly spread west to Europe before hitting Wall Street, where the Dow fell by nearly 25%. The nation's property markets proved to be the primary drivers of the boom-to-bust character of our economic system. The wave of financial deregulation began with a 1978 Supreme Court decision that authorized banks to expand the usury laws of their home state nationwide. In 1980, passage of the Depository Institutions Deregulation and Monetary Control Act increased deposit insurance from $40,000 to $100,000, with ironic consequences on prudent bank lending policies. The 1982 Garn-St. Germain Depository Institutions Act deregulated the savings institutions altogether. For the first time, the thrifts were permitted to issue certificates of deposit in competition with the money market mutual funds. However, for many thrifts, the authority came much too late to prevent bankruptcy. By the end of 1985, rising property prices pushed Fannie and Freddie to raise the loan limit for a one-family property to $115,300. Seems rather modest today. By 1987, mounting failures of thrifts absorbed all of the premium reserves held by the Federal Savings and Loan Insurance Corporation. It took two more years, but in 1989, regulation of the thrifts was transferred to the Office of Thrift Supervision, and responsibility to depositors came under the FDIC. Are they collecting sufficient premiums for the next downturn? We will find out. Ronald Reagan signed two bills reducing federal taxes in 1981 and 1986. A critical side effect of the 1986 Act was a dramatic increase in consumer spending secured by mortgage liens on residential property. By 1989, consumer debt doubled. The Iraqi invasion of Kuwait in 1990 triggered another spike in oil prices, and the U.S. economy fell into yet another recession. Corporate restructurings and mergers accelerated. All restrictions on interstate banking ended in 1994. Next came the demise of Glass-Steagall, achieved during the Clinton years in office. Clinton then signed legislation in 2000 preventing regulation of the over-the-counter derivative contracts. The derivatives market skyrocketed. Asset managers on Wall Street sought ways to generate nominal yield for investors and fees for themselves. They found their answer in private label mortgage-backed securities, the new junk bonds. In 2000, Fannie and Freddie increased their loan limits on one-family property to $252,700. In 2004, the Securities and Exchange Commission relaxed the rates on leverage for five leading banks. You probably know them. The beneficiaries were Goldman Sachs, Morgan Stanley, Merrill Lynch, Lehman Brothers, and Bear Stearns. 4 years later, only two of the five survived, and they required government bailout. It's not a happy story that I'm delivering, am I? Also, in 2004, the Comptroller of the Currency preempted state laws regulating anti-predatory lending laws. Following this change, national lenders sold increasingly risky loan products in those states. Defaults and foreclosures skyrocketed. By 2005, Fannie and Freddie set maximum loan limits on a one-family property at $359,650, higher in New York and other high-cost markets. Land prices were increasing at double-digit rates. As defaults snowballed, investors left the private label mortgage-backed security market, then the entire mortgage-backed security market altogether. The balance sheets of Fannie and Freddie collapsed. The financial meltdown had arrived. The really scary thing is the failure of our government and other governments to focus on the systemic flaws in our economic systems so long ago identified by Henry George. Fed policy focused on recovery of property markets to bail out mortgage loan investors and homeowners who, if still employed, could refinance out of high-cost subprime mortgage loans. However, with household incomes not growing, the demand for housing has again softened, other than the investor market. The analysis of Mason Gaffney, Joseph Stiglitz, and other economists who have gained insight from Henry George have to this point been ignored. So what are the chances for real reform? We shall see, but I suggest don't hold your breath. Thank you.
And of course, the obvious question for you is, how did your experience at Fannie Mae adjust your thinking on the George's theory and practice?
Yeah, well, understanding Henry George made me a very fearful person as the decade of the 90s and 2000s unfolded, because I was looking at data all the time that it confirmed what Henry George was telling us and what our economist friends like Mason Gaffney and Nick Tiedemann were telling us. And I tried to convince our senior people at Fannie Mae that we need to look closely at the property markets, at land values. Mm-hmm. I just couldn't get anyone to pay attention.
Well, of course, from a layman's point of view, reading the newspapers and magazines at the time, of course, it was highly politicized, Fannie Mae. And that being the case, that there was a trend to establish home ownership on a wide basis, even if you had to push the margins. What was your attitude toward that?
Well, those of us who were producing the business and working with lenders, we thought that it was a good idea to increase home ownership and to make credit available to first-time home buyers and minorities, but to do it prudently. And so we agonized over every step we took. Every time we looked at our credit analysis and looked at credit scores and the documentation to support our lending policies, we made hard decisions. We tried to implement them in a reasonable way, and actually I think we did an excellent job.
Because the obvious question is documentation. I mean, none of this could have gone on if documentation was thoroughly examined. Given what has been reported since about fraudulent paperwork, lying, nothing checked, magazines showing blatant misrepresentation on a broad scale of documentation, how could you as a federal government agency have let that go?
I can't respond to what happened after 2005 because I'd been retired. Mm-hmm. But prior to that time, none of that occurred at Fannie Mae.
Okay.
And our documentation for a first-time home buyer not only required full documentation of income and employment, credit history, but everyone had to take home buyer education classes.
The obvious question, of course, is what is the single most important economic reform you think should occur to prevent a crisis like this from occurring again?
What should have occurred right away, and I side with Mason Gaffney on this, is that the first thing the federal government should have done was prohibit banks from extending credit for the purchase of land or acceptance of land as collateral for borrowing. That would have protected the banks from themselves, and it would have protected us as taxpayers from the banks.
You're just talking about land purchase, not land plus building.
I'm talking about land only, yes.
So I was a newly graduated student now in England. Having left New Jersey, I went to England, and my sponsors, the Rhodes Trust, arranged for us to visit places and to stay with families. And so I was with my friend from Stanford. We were headed to Loch Ness to see Nessie. And the marvelous British railroad system collapsed for us in York. And we couldn't get out of York, and it was about two-thirds of the way from London to Scotland. It was late at night, and there was only one place lit that we could see. We were walking all around the railway station and all through York. It was called the Ebor Cafe, Roman, supposedly. We went in, identified ourselves as Americans studying in England, and he said, "Have you read Henry George?" Well, I had, my friend hadn't. I spent the next 3 hours talking about Henry George. They put us up, they fed us, and took us to the rail station the next day. But by luck, I had read Henry George, not in an economics class at Princeton, but in an American history class. I don't remember what I said to him or what he said to me, but I do remember agreeing very strongly with the motive expressed by the title, Progress and Poverty. The same economic mechanism, the same system, institutional system and market system that generates wealth generates poverty. Skip to the present. There's a lot of study done on GNP. I don't want to go into any of the technicalities, but people have identified many shortcomings of GNP. You smoke cigarettes, all the cigarettes are added up. You treat cancer, all the cancer treatments are added up, and you add them together, right? That we're very well off. Twice as well off as if we didn't smoke. So there are some problems. But statisticians are clever. Statisticians think things through, and they come out with relatively coherent things. So let me just say that in spite of all of the problems, GNP is a sensible, rational measure, imperfect to be sure, but still a measure of the wealth generated annually by the market economy. Now, what are we going to do about all the rest of it? Well, James Tobin suggested we have net economic welfare, a different set of measures. Many economists, the Levy Institute publishes something of this sort. Many economists at NYU, at Harvard, all have developed different measures of what broadly can be considered net economic welfare. That is, what is the impact on the well-being of the population of the United States of what is economically done? Now, look over the history of the economy from the post-war period. Statisticians have tried to work this out. You see the growth of GNP, and you see the growth of net economic welfare. Oops. Net economic welfare grows kind of flat in the 1980s, and even flatter in the 1990s, and pretty soon it more or less stops. Different measures all show the same pattern, but it happens at different dates. Remember, these measures are taking up many things that are economic activities, like housework, but which are not included in the GNP because they're not paid, they're not market. They're also taking into account environmental damage. There are many different estimates of environmental damage. They're trying to eliminate the stupid double counting of cigarettes and cancer treatments. They're trying to modify all kinds of things in order. So there are different patterns of modification. But the picture that they show of GNP and economic well-being growing together in the late 40s, the 50s, the 60s, faltering in the 70s, separating in the 1980s, and then economic welfare going pretty flat. Think of it another way. GNP is failing to buy economic welfare. It's just not happening. The market system, in a sense, has failed the population of the United States. It can't make us better off. This, again, is, in a sense, the same message that you get from Henry George, that the progress which is being developed, the additions of wealth, is being offset by the generation of poverty and economic damage. Only this time, it's being measured, imperfectly to be sure, but there is an effort to measure this. Now let's look a little bit at the history of, this is a very condensed and a very opinionated picture of economic history since the 19th century. With respect to this issue, Henry George suggested a Ricardian mechanism, that the expansion of the economy, the development of industry, the development of progress would bring in more workers, would expand, and would put pressure on land. And pressure on land, in the Ricardian sense, leads to the increase in rents. I won't go into the details of the mechanism, but this is broadly acceptable. This rise in rents is capable of absorbing what would otherwise go to profit and wages. Problem, which pays more into the pool of rents? Broadly speaking, the answer, well, Henry George argued that both did, but broadly speaking, it probably hit labor harder. And there were a variety of mechanisms, including and especially the move towards monopoly, which would protect profits. Another 19th century economist had a different picture. Marx proposed what he called the general law of capitalist accumulation. Marx argued that the expansion of the economy required expansion of industry at the expense of agriculture, that you would have a flow of labor coming in from the countryside, be attracted in. As that flow of labor comes in, they compete with workers in the urban and industrial sectors. Wages fall, expand faster. As you expand faster, you drive up the wages until there is a turning point where you have a collapse in the urban sector. and a crisis. No mention of rents in this. But it's very plausible. You have expansion at the expense of agriculture all through the 19th century, all through the 20th century. The time Henry George was writing, there was certainly over half the economy was agricultural, probably a good deal more. Depends on, and it was small business too, mostly the non-agricultural sector. But what we see in Marx is an emphasis on the changing character of the economy. And this is a little bit missing in George, although he notices it and he talks about industry, but he's very interested in talking about industry and talking about the way in which economic power is used and monopoly. You can put these together and you see the forces driving the economy of the 19th century. I think they belong together because I think the insight of Marx in the changing character of the economy is extremely important. And I think the sense, which Marx wants to say, but Marx says the rich get richer and the poor get poorer, but he doesn't prove it. He doesn't even prove it in an intellectual model-building way, let alone statistically. This wasn't quite true. The poor didn't get poorer. The poor actually got better off in many respects. The rich certainly got richer. So we need these to be balanced. And we have a very interesting picture. But the change from a mixed agricultural industrial economy to a predominantly urban, predominantly industrial and service economy, a change in the character of services also from largely domestic to largely business services. This change, and then the change that follows that, as blue-collar labor shrinks and white-collar labor expands, again, changes the character of the economy. And this shows up in a kind of a very interesting way. In the 19th century, I think it's fair to say that the growth of the economy is what might be called extensive. That's why the Henry George story of Ricardian rents works so well. The economy expands by getting bigger. You go west, you import people. People come from Europe to America. The cities grow not by migration from the Illinois countryside to Chicago, but by migration from Lithuania and southern Italy to Chicago. They're coming from the countryside, but they're not coming from the Illinois countryside. It's extensive growth. You have more people, more businesses, more land, everything else. But as we get into the 20th century, in the second half of the 20th century, a lot of our growth, about half of it, maybe more, is what might be called intensive growth. It's the productivity of the system that's growing. Not the number of people, but what the people can do. That's the growth, and that's technological. If you want to think about a pure case of this, take Germany. Germany is a pure case of intensive growth. There's no extensive growth. There may even be extensive shrinkage. But it's a very fast-growing economy. So intensive growth becomes much more important. And intensive growth, the technological improvement, learning by doing, one famous economist called it. You learn by starting out a new method, and you try it out, and you learn, you make mistakes, you redo it, you redesign the product. And you think about any long-growing market. That's what happens. You don't really know what the product is. What was an automobile in 1896? How many wheels did it have? How was it steered? Was it covered? What was the transmission like? What we see under mass production is a different pattern of prices, a different pattern of wages, a different pattern of output and labor. In the old economy, before mass production, fluctuations took place in the economy, but they were mostly fluctuations in prices. Prices went up and prices went down. Wages went up, and money wages went up and they went down. Output expanded and contracted, but interestingly enough, although output expanded and contracted, employment didn't vary quite so much. The variation of employment was much less than the variation in output, meaning very large numbers of workers were tied to their place of work. Not surprising when you think about a lot of small proprietorships, a lot of partnerships. This is a different institutional structure than the giant corporation running a system of assembly lines and mass production. Very different. You don't have layoffs. The word layoff occurs for the first time in an economic context in the Massachusetts state legislature in about 1896, talking about laying off labor. Prior to that, it's simply not a concept, and it's not a practice. When did you lay off workers? When you went bankrupt. When there was large-scale bankruptcies in a crisis, then there would be workers thrown into the streets. But otherwise, some inessential workers might be dismissed, but generally speaking, you kept your work team together. Why? Because it was a team. And the team had interlocking skills, and they knew how to work together. The world changed with mass production, with steam engine, and then it made an even bigger change with electric and internal combustion power. You didn't have to depend on the weather, you didn't have to depend on water, you didn't have to depend on anything. You had a power source run by fuel that you were in full control of, and you could run everything, and you had enormous number of workers. So prices became stable. Prices were set so as to generate the kind of surplus that would pay for the very large financial costs of building these huge factories and enable the business to plan its market ahead for years. You set the price not in terms of current supply and demand, but in terms of current plus expected future supply and demand. And you set your prices in a long-term strategy because you were looking ahead to see how the market developed. Why? Because you had to build a factory that would serve the market 5 years or even 10 years ahead. So you're building ahead of demand, and you're planning a price strategy ahead of demand. And why do you do all of this? Because you reap immense economies of scale. And these immense economies of scale mean that you are a giant firm and you have a lot of market power. And it interacts. You become a giant firm because you can exercise some market power. Once you are a giant firm, you can exercise market power and plan your strategies ahead. So prices become relatively stable. Employment varies, but here's where Galbraith comes in with his idea of countervailing power. In order to employ this large number of workers, you have to make sure that they aren't going to burn down your plant. And we know from the Pullman strike, we know from the Carnegie strike, we know from the 19th century that this was a real danger. You needed to have a labor union in order to manage. And once you did that, then there's no longer supply and demand for money wages. Money wages are planned also. So money wages are planned, money prices are planned. The variation in the system, when demand varies, it's output that varies, and therefore it's labor that varies, employment. You lay off and you hire back in reverse seniority, last hired, first fired. And the layoff process is managed by the labor unions. This changes the character of the economy. In the 19th century, the predominant fluctuations are in prices and money wages. In the 20th century, the late 20th century, especially the Great Depression is the big statistical watershed in this. In the late 20th century, a recession or depression is predominantly output and employment, not prices and wages. Different world. But we still have progress and poverty. It's a different world, but it's a world that still produces poverty. It's a world that produces progress. It's a world in which we have expanding wealth, but it's a world in which we have ilth as well. We have environmental damage. Up and down, all around. We have the production of massive amounts of garbage. We have the production of massive amounts of sewage, and they pollute our lakes and streams. Lake Erie catches fire. This is incredible. Nobody could have thought of this in the 19th century, that a lake would catch fire because of what we dump into it. There's some other things, too, which are these are not as large, but they may be as, in some sense, powerful. Let's call it addictive consumption. Most obvious cases, cigarettes and alcohol. Addictive consumption. This is a very good thing because your customers are really tied to you or to the product. But addictive consumption, as these cases, tends to be very damaging. And in the long term, alcohol, and in the long term, even sometimes in the short term, tobacco is dangerous. What about illegal drugs, prescription drugs, addiction to prescription drugs? Again, it's damaging. But one of the worst cases is the combination of salt, sugar, and fat. Which spells McDonald's. And this combination produces what? The obesity crisis. It's very damaging. It shows up in mortality statistics. It shows up in life expectation statistics. It's big. It's a big problem. And it shows up in all kinds of hospital admissions. Gambling, again, addictive consumption. But if you start thinking about this, and maybe a couple of other things come to mind. Automobiles. We're addicted to automobiles. We do not have, one goes to Europe, and there's public transport everywhere. We don't have it. Partly because the oil companies brought up the streetcar companies and ripped up the tracks. But again, the American way of life is built around the automobile, and we don't. What are the statistics? These accident and death statistics to automobiles are pretty sensational. Guns. I don't really probably need to say much more than that. But again, the fascination with guns and the tremendous emotional attachment to them is a kind of addiction. And the disastrous consequences are very clear in the suicide statistics and in homicide statistics. But that's, okay, it's terrible. 16,000 suicides, about 10,000 homicides, something like that. You can look up, Siri will tell you. What we don't realize is that for every person that's killed by a gun, five or six are wounded. And they are going to have to be taken care of in hospitals, and many of them are going to have to be taken care of the rest of their lives. That's where the real money is. All of these are features of our economy which are produced by, in a sense, the competitive market structure built into our social system, the interaction of those. And they tend to generate, for better or worse, call it ilth. And in the worst case of all, the financial system and the growth of the financial system. In 1965, we had what Hyminsky used to call a suppressed financial system. There were caps on interest rates, there were strong regulations, and the banking system was fighting for its freedom. And we had over 4% growth, we had 3% productivity growth, we had very little inflation, and we had unemployment properly measured, better measured then, not maybe not properly, but better measured then, that was very low. Contrast to the 1980s, where we have a financial system that's been set at liberty, and we have low growth, and we have very poor economic performance. In a sense, this increase from about 12 to 13% of the GNP to 20%, that's the growth of the financial sector, has dragged the economy down. But stop and think about what is the financial sector. This isn't completely true, but it's largely true. They're a cost. A cost of the economy has gone from a little bit over 10% to about 20%. It's doubled. That is a drag on the economy. What I would say is that this is the new, and what is the financial sector? A large chunk of it is real estate. It's land speculation, it's real estate speculation, it's a whole bag of things that take up and use real resources but don't yield much in terms of economic well-being for the population. In short, it's an indictment of the market economy. Thank you.
Ed, glad to have you here.
Delighted to be here.
All right. Now, my question to you, of course, is a prominent economic theorist covering two continents, if not more. You've observed the financial crisis as it's unfolded. You're very familiar with the theory of Henry George. You're very familiar with macroeconomic theory. What would you have done if you were reconstructing macroeconomic theory to use Henry George's insights to prevent what had happened in 2008?
Well, I think that the developments of the previous 20 to 30 years saw an expansion of what we call FIRE, finance, insurance, and real estate. This encompasses a good part of what Henry George worried very much about, which was land values, land speculation, and the role of the banking system in promoting speculation in land values. That was the 19th century. Since then, the scope of speculation by financial institutions has enormously broadened to the point where it encompasses more or less 20% of the economy. 20% goes into finance, insurance, and real estate. And they absorb many of the best mathematicians and physicists in the world.
and they produce some services which are of use to everybody, but they also produce massive speculation. And that speculation leads to crashes. And we have seen many crises, commercial crises, currency crises, speculation in all kinds of things, and of course the housing speculation, which was a real estate speculation, and which led directly to the crash of 2008. So the focus on speculation and a core part of speculation is real estate. This is straight out of Henry George, and it is what preceded and brought the crisis of 2008.
Given the fact that speculation is rampant, there's been a call, and there's been writers from Stiglitz, I think the former budget director of Clinton, mm-hmm. is now calling for land taxes, or taxes on land or near land resources to dampen the speculation. Historically, that was written out of the economic lexicon mm-hmm. by the time the neoclassicals conflated or combined capital with resources and land. How would that be on track? Is it feasible from an economic point of view? Is it possible from a detailed point of view, the way the GMP accounts are constructed today, for example?
Well, I don't see that. Statisticians and tax experts are very good at devising taxes and very good at separating out the different aspects of holdings of wealth, in dividing it into categories that make sense, and of course some that don't, to avoid taxes. But I think, first of all, there is a very direct tax which could be imposed. It was proposed first by James Tobin, the Tobin tax, mm-hmm. on speculation itself, and variants of that tax have been proposed.
It's almost like a Piketty tax. It's on the security itself, not the underlying asset.
And I think that is important, but I think the problem of focusing exclusively on real estate or on derivatives from real estate is that besides real estate, there is this massive problem of resources, of which oil and natural gas are the most obvious, but go through all of the minerals. They're absolutely vital to the economy, to our economy, and to the global economy. And they are largely unregulated. Great environmental damage is done in their production. And there is no attempt to work out a rational use of these resources mm-hmm. while they last over the expected lifetime of the quantity of resources that we have. I think this is a bigger problem.
Alexandra, the obvious question, how did you get interested in Henry George and why is he relevant today?
All right. Well, when I was still an undergraduate back at the University of Pacific in California, I was looking for a topic to write a history honors thesis. And I asked my dad one day, did you have any ideas? I don't know what to write about. And he said, well, yeah, you know, I remember my favorite book at the University of Missouri that I read in the one history course that I took was Progress and Poverty, and he still had his copy from college. So he gave it to me, and I started reading it and got interested and did a little research. And I wrote my honors thesis on Henry George and mostly the influence of his ideas in California. And a couple years later, after I graduated, I decided to pursue graduate work in history at Brandeis. And I hadn't intended to write my dissertation on Henry George, but I was in the American History program, and every unit I could find some connection with Henry George, his followers, and his ideas. So I just stopped fighting it and decided, all right, I better write a dissertation on Henry George. And so that's what I did.
And why is he relevant today, Alexandra?
Well, you know, as a historian, it's hard not to make parallels between what's going on socially and economically today and what was happening during Henry George's time and when he was really doing the research for Progress and Poverty. The credit market collapse of 2008 had so many parallels to the panic of 1873. So I think we can learn a lot in terms of how we approach the questions of why, despite the increase of wealth and the increase of progress, do we still have this wide gap between the wealthy and the poor? And I think Henry George and the way he tackled this question and the kinds of, you know, questions he really looked at, not just economically, but how does this affect us as a civilization, would be really useful and helpful to statespeople and the people in making policy today.